Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for still being here. My name's Craig Evans. I'm from the Electricity Authority. I want you to imagine that tomorrow, Sparky, New Zealand distributor, comes up with the most efficient pricing structure that's ever been dreamt up in the world. And the next day, they rolled it out. And then the day after, they started receiving the complaints from everybody, because they hadn't sort of realised they needed a particular sort of metering technology. They hadn't realised that their billing system wasn't quite up for it. They hadn't spoken to any of the retailers that were passing, that were accepting this product, nor had they told the consumers at the end that were seeing the results of this why they were doing it, what was happening, and the fact that some people would win and lose. And I think that's sort of what we're talking about. The what is important, but how the industry gets there is just as or possibly more important. And that was a clear message that we got that was clearly in the submissions that, hey, things like transition, communication and managing consumer impacts are really important. So just to be clear, what are these three things about? Three aspects to the process: transition, communication, managing consumer impacts. Transition, the practical steps that need to be taken to introduce new price structures and the time frame. We've already heard a little bit about this today. Is it April 2018? Is it a bit longer? Is it different for different distributors? Do you need some sort of penetration or metering technology before you can actually make a start? What is it? Does everybody know what it is? What about billing systems of distributors and retailers? Are they able to cope with it? How long is it going to take to be able to have it in place? Communication. So what is communicated to consumers? How, when, and by whom? And how easy is it for that to go horribly wrong? If a retailer and a distributor are saying giving two different messages to the same consumer on different days of the week, I'm pretty sure that the result of that is confusion and complaint. Finally, managing consumer impacts. This was a clear theme in submissions. It's making sure that all parties understand and manage the expectation of consumers relating to the introduction of new distribution price structures. Boiled it down, there'll be winners and there'll be losers. You tend to hear from losers, less so from the winners, because things are just happening as they are. So how is that conversation managed with those consumers? Thank you, and hopefully we'll have a useful discussion about this now.
Right, so first perspective. Networks Association, as you've heard, have already been sort of looking at distribution pricing. Emma, I think you're talking as Network Tasman, aren't you, rather than representing the views of ENA, but a bit like Nathan, you know, you've been in the room with the other guys, there's a lot of consistency of view. Our first perspective is from Emma Lanigan. Now, Emma, you're the commercial and regulatory something or other, aren't you, at Network Tasman? And if my memory serves me right, you were in telco before you joined us. Yeah, so several people today have mentioned, I mean, Mark's been talking about airport pricing and changes in airport pricing several times, which again is a fairly sort of robust process. And several people have raised telco as an example of an industry that's made a very similar transition and really has rebundled its prices into completely different forms for transportation capacity. There is quite a lot to learn from these other industries. So, Emma, please come to the stage and you can have 10 minutes. So that would be great. Excellent.
Okay, thanks for that introduction. You know, as you mentioned, I'm the regulatory and commercial manager at Network Tasman, but I'm also the chair of the future pricing subgroup that was established by the ENA's broader distribution working group. So I've been asked to present my views as chair of the subgroup on the process that the industry should follow to ensure that the rollout of new distribution pricing is a success for distributors, for retailers, and retail competition more generally, and crucially for consumers. And this draws on some of the work that we've been doing within the subgroup. The distribution pricing working group has been focused for some time now on developing more cost-reflective pricing for residential and small business connections in particular. Most recently, we have been preparing the ENA's consultation paper on future distribution pricing. We expect to release that paper within the next few weeks and look forward to hearing your feedback on that. Following that consultation, the ENA and the Distribution Pricing Working Group intends to reflect on the responses submitted by interested parties with the ultimate goal of producing a guidance paper for distributors on pricing options, including templates for alignment and advice on implementation. So here's a bit of an overview of how we've been approaching it. Looking at the drivers of change, some of the different pricing options and weighing up the relative strengths of those pricing options. But crucially, there are several chapters in the consultation paper that are particularly relevant to this session. They address stakeholder engagement, implementation and transition. And in those chapters, we draw on international experience, established principles and approaches. So really looking to, in this paper, bring together a base of information that distributors can draw on and that can also stimulate the debate with stakeholders. I'll stress at this point that the ENA hasn't arrived at an agreed position on how to manage the transition to new pricing. We have a good idea of the questions that we need to ask, and as I've said, put together a really good information base to draw on, but we don't yet have the answers, and we look forward to working together with you to progress that work. A few things that we do know at this stage, though, are that it won't be easy to do it well. Distributors will need to adopt an approach that's most appropriate for their individual situation. One size won't necessarily fit all. But overriding all of this should be the following question: which approach will serve consumers best? Whether we're distributors, retailers, or the regulator, this fundamental question should be at the heart of all our decisions on the process of moving to these new pricing options. It's clear that in order to transition to new distribution pricing, four key parties need to be involved. These are clearly distributors who need to consult with stakeholders, consumers, retailers, regulators, and other interested parties to develop pricing. This can be done following some well-established principles for consultation. And we also have looked to the ENA Australia. They published a handbook where they've established and discussed a social license concept, kind of really explaining to consumers what's driving this need for change in pricing. Drawing on consultation feedback, distributors will need to develop and deliver to the market new pricing structures that meet the needs and expectations of consumers and retailers, whilst ensuring that these prices are as efficient and cost-reflective as they can reasonably be. Distributors and retailers will need to agree communications about the changes that proceed. For example, customer education around what the pricing means, how it works, and the purpose of the changes. Secondly, retailers will need to provide input into the development of new pricing options offered by distributors and then develop and implement their retail strategy. Thirdly, the electricity authority, who will need to act as a neutral market facilitator and, if needed, but only if needed, intervene to ensure that the maximum possible benefits from the introduction of new distribution pricing options are realised. Fourthly, consumers, who will be presented with opportunities for consultation and communicated to by all of the parties above, but consumers will ultimately play an important role in driving what is offered and how effectively it works. Establishing clear roles and responsibilities for these parties, in particular the industry participants and the regulator will help to ensure that the process of communicating the proposed changes with consumers will go as smoothly as possible. It will be important to make the transition to new pricing distribution options a success. The authority's guidelines in this area are a useful starting point. Moving on to the practical implementation of new pricing options, there are a number of considerations that distributors and retailers will need to take into account. And here's a few examples. Is the smart metering infrastructure available at a sufficiently large proportion of consumer ICPs to support my chosen pricing option, particularly for ICP billing? If not, am I confident that using some kind of profile data for those customers without a smart meter will be acceptable? What do the retailers trading on my network expect or require? What are consumers' preferences in this regard? And are my billing systems sufficiently advanced that they can accommodate the new pricing options? If not, how long will it take and how much will it cost to make them capable of this? What about the retailers trading on my network? Can they all accommodate the new pricing, or only some of them, or none of them? Moving on from these practical issues, we also need to think about the effects of new pricing options on our consumers, in particular vulnerable consumers. So when considering new pricing, it becomes apparent that there will be winners and losers. So some consumers will see, on average, lower distribution bills, and some would result in higher distribution bills. So here's just an example of how a distributor might look at the impacts on different customer segments. So we've got a few different household types here, focusing really on residential consumers. This is just an illustrative example, but for each type of customer, you can look at the load profile of that customer and then estimate the impact on the pricing for them. And where the effects are judged to be potentially very significant, there can be consideration given to a range of managed or phased implementation options, and communication and coordination with the retailers will be important on that too. So there are a range of ways to address adverse consumer impacts. We've surveyed a number of these and looked for both local and international examples. So this table just is a bit of a snippet out of our report, just a few examples here about how the adverse impacts can be managed. The first one, for example, with a phase rebalance, you can imagine if a capacity charge was introduced, that could be a small component of revenue to start with, keeping the legacy pricing in place, perhaps, and then over time the weighting essentially on the capacity charge could be increased with the other pricing components reduced over time. So there's an example here of in Australia that kind of approach was used to phase in, or is planned to be used to phase in demand charges. So this approach has some clear benefits of introducing customers to the concept of cost-reflective charges with limited financial impact to start with, so that they can get to grips with the new pricing first and have time to adjust their behaviour if necessary. Then another option, for example, would be a cap on the pricing increase. There's an example of Wellington Electricity doing that, capping the effect of pricing to 6%. Or alternatively, particularly if you're moving to peak demand, for example, there might be a cap on the billed quantities. But in all of this, there's trade-offs between how quickly to move to cost-reflective pricing versus managing the consumer impact. There are also some other transition strategy options here as well. And again, this is just a selection of a few that we've looked at in the report. So one obvious one is having an opt-in period before moving to a mandatory implementation. So you might set a period of, say, 3 years, for example, within the first 2 years consumers can opt in, and this allows for some teething issues all around, really, in terms of not at the on day one having 100% of consumers having to transition over to the new pricing. There's also here an example of having a mandatory implementation of new pricing but with an opt-out pricing option. Voluntary pricing options often don't have especially high take-up, and we've seen that here, I suppose, following from the earlier discussion on time of use pricing. We've got shadow pricing as another option that we've looked at. So that's where you might have legacy pricing still in place, but on the bill the consumer could see the pricing that they would face under the new pricing that's going to be introduced. In theory, this could be a good thing, but there could be some customer confusion, perhaps, with having two different amounts on their bills, and some complexity in implementation. And then final option here was the one that Michelle discussed earlier with regard to Well Networks. Just one way of phasing in would be to just focus on a small group of consumers first, such as the new connections. As I alluded to earlier, we don't have the answers yet, and we're really interested to understand the views of those in other parts of the industry, and also to understand what action is being taken by other parties on these issues. The industry as a whole needs to work together if we're going to make the transition to new distribution pricing a success. Distributors have already begun this journey. Are you ready to join us? Thanks.
Many thanks, Emma. So as we've said repeatedly, I mean, the ENA's been on this for quite a long time already, and there's quite a lot that's about to start hitting the streets quite soon, so this is not a sort of green field context. But it's not just about the distributors. So I've talked quite a lot about Flick through the day, but they've been very, very quiet. So maybe give Steve an opportunity to come and give a retailer perspective on the transition. And I'm mumbling because I'm waiting for you to get up here. Cheers.
10 minutes. Thanks, John. Hi, I'm Steve O'Connor from Flick Electric. We're pretty interested in this topic because we actually have a pass-through model. So for every network that we're in and network tariff, we attempt to pass it through to the consumer. So we believe the networks are trying to do the right thing, trying to create efficiencies and trying to make the industry work well, and we try and pass that through. So we're inherently interested in what's being considered, and we also have a big focus on the customer, and very, very keen to make sure that whatever we do as an industry, it's actually good for the end consumer, because without them we're fairly stuffed. And my first slide is actually now redundant, because I was wondering how often today I'd hear the word consumer, and I thought I'd start taking account, and I've lost count, which is fantastic. So, you know, congratulate everyone for putting the focus on that. But I thought, you know, start with some context, and, you know, why are we doing this? And there's the old framework that the Electricity Authority has, which we actually refer to quite often to get a sense of why we're looking at all these different things. And that one there that says improved price signals, fantastic to see that there. But right alongside it, improved consumer participation. I think it's really important that we make sure we recognise that those two separate strategies are actually quite closely tied together with the topic that we're talking about today. But I'm pleased to say that actually I don't really need to reinforce this, because we've been talking about the consumer an awful lot, which is great. But what I do like to do, and this I guess is the way I think and work, is that I like to think about what the problem is, but I've tried to put it in a better context of what's the challenge that we're facing together. And it does feel like it's a little bit of a seesaw, and we're trying to find a balance here. And on one side, we've got that need to improve price signals, and I think that's absolutely absolute necessity given the change that the industry is facing, but at the same time we want to improve consumer participation. So how do we do that successfully? And when I've thought about this, when you think about improving price signals and from a network perspective, my sense at least is that it's kind of like it's an engineering thing. It's about cost and total cost and how that cost is shaped. It's about the asset and the return on that asset. It's about the potential for the stranding of that asset. And that starts to form and shape the view of pricing from a network point of view, which is fantastic. And I suspect there's truckloads of individual analysis that's been done by networks, collectively by ENA. There's a lot of analysis that's been done in this space. And then when you think of it from a consumer point of view, you know, interestingly, increasingly, these guys are thinking from a value-based point of view, which historically probably hasn't been the case. In many respects, consumers, at least in the electricity industry, they've been price takers, product takers, and service takers, but it's definitely changing, and it's actually going to flip. And I think this is an important thing for us to remember, is that they're going to get much wider choice very, very shortly. We've heard about, you know, PV and solar and the fact that that's coming down. And so as an industry, one, I think we have to learn and start to learn much more about consumers and what they actually want. We have to appreciate that they do want more choice, and that they're going to have wider alternatives critically. So how do we make sure that we improve their participation and their engagement in decisions that we might make? And then, of course, we've got the retailers, of which we're one, and there's a number around the country that have a consideration as well. And for retailers, they're kind of thinking about, from a price point of view, you know, will customers understand and value prices that could be sent through? Will they meet the customer's needs? And what kind of customer segments will benefit from it and which may not benefit from it. Can those signals actually be sent through? So is it the right price structure? What's the cost of a system to send that through? So, you know, the retailers are responsible primarily for billing the customers at the moment. What's it actually going to take to send that price signal through, and how much will that cost? How hard is it going to be to do? And what are the risks does it create? Certainly from a retailer point of view, if we put our hat on, there's brand risk, there's customer risk, there's system risk and costs of systems, there's margin risk, and for some retailers who do more than just retailing, there's probably a business model risk as well. So, and then of course you have the EA sitting over the top of this thinking, how do we get this industry actually to pull, that could potentially pull in different directions, working together successfully for the best possible outcomes. So I guess the summary of that is that it's complex, there's multiple stakeholders that have differing views. You would argue probably on that basis that perhaps it should be design-led as an industry. So we heard earlier today that, you know, we need to be working collaboratively to figure out what this is. You'd probably argue that it shouldn't be mandated. So we've heard discussions about whether it should actually just simply be put in place and, guys, this is what it's going to be. And at the other end, it probably shouldn't just be open slather and people doing whatever they want to do also. So, you know, it really is a major risk of misalignment between a lot of different stakeholders that have differing views. I thought I'd just dwell on this quickly because I'm going to share some learnings that we've had at Flick, and I don't know whether everyone knows what our model is, but it is a pass-through model, as I've explained, so we can't ignore those network prices. If we go into a network here where we're truly going to try and pass that network price signal through to customers, and I guess what that's actually meant for us is that we've started learning an awful lot in attempting to do that. One of the things we've learnt is when it's really challenging to pass that through, and actually when it's impossible to do so. So some network price structures that are out there at the moment, we simply cannot give that to the customer. We're unable to. So when you're thinking about the price structures that we might consider that are a bit more cost reflective, actually we need to think about whether they can actually be passed to the customer in the future, which ones work and which ones don't. We've become very aware of whether that creates a cost for us in delivering it, so the systems, and we've become very aware of whether there's a risk in a retailer of doing so, whether that's from a customer perspective, whether it's from a margin perspective. And we're also very aware and increasingly aware, because our customers are engaging with this model, what they think of these price structures. Do they understand them? Do they engage with them? Do they respond to them importantly? So we're on a big learning curve from that perspective as well. So with that in mind, I thought I'd just whack through a few of the learnings we've actually had at Flick that hopefully might provide some useful information. So the first thing I'd say is that actually consumers are more sophisticated than we might think they are with the context of the electricity industry. So, you know, think about us as consumers as we go to the supermarket. There's something like over 1,000 decisions we make when we shop in a given week when we go to the supermarket. Consumers are actually really, really sophisticated, and there's a whole lot of other industries that have recognised that and give consumers much more choice. The second thing I'd say is that the majority, and I'm not saying all, but the majority are actually hungry for more transparency and much more choice. They're going to get much more choice with time, but they are genuinely hungry for this. And that's proved by other industries as well. So if you look at the telco industry and the choices you're now getting there, the entertainment industry, lots of these other utilities are uncovering the fact that consumers do want more choice. Importantly, with regard to price signals, it's really important that there's strong communication and that that's backed by tools. So as you can imagine in the model that we have in Flick, this is absolutely essential. We haven't always got it right, and we're still learning actually how do you communicate these price signals, these different price structures, and what kind of information tools do you give customers so that they can potentially benefit from it. It's not an easy thing to do, and it's certainly a long runway, and I think when you think about the implementation of different price structures and price levels for consumers going forward, we have to bear in mind this is going to be a journey that we're going to go on with consumers. Certainly the right price structure and level will produce strong demand response. So price elasticity, particularly when it relates to residential consumers, is absolutely something that happens and happens with our customers. When we modelled and thought about putting this out in the marketplace, we thought consumers would save somewhere between about 7 and 8% based on all the analytics that we could do based on the model. What we couldn't calculate was how customers would respond to those price signals. And our customers' lifetime to date have saved about 20%. And that difference is the reflection that a large portion of them are actually responding to the prices. If it's meaningful, they can understand it, and they can respond to it, then they will do so. And they are significant, as I've said, with that lifetime to date. Interestingly, we have some customers that lifetime to date have saved over 50% off their total bill. So there are portions of customers, and I'm not suggesting it's everyone, that really will respond to price signals. But we don't expect all customers to want that. So we've heard today that some customers they just want might be all you can eat, might cost you $10, it could cost you $3, I'll just pay the $10, thanks very much. So we do recognise price signals aren't necessarily for all consumers, or they may not respond to those price signals. I really did like, and I think Greg mentioned this, that concept of what's my number, potentially moving to what's my choice. And what's my behaviour, and I think that's the real opportunity for the industry as a whole as we transition to different price structures. So some stuff that we've learned about the network pricing itself, and the first thing I'll say is that we're all absolutely learning here critically, and none of this is as a criticism, because when I think about the industry and its history, with customers predominantly being price takers, product takers and service takers, is that we're learning every time we put something new in the market. But certainly what we feel at the moment is that there's probably pretty limited understanding of true price elasticity of demand as it relates to price signals. It's probably really hard for network companies. You get a chance once a year to try something new. And you don't want to get it wrong, right? Otherwise your revenues are impacted. So we're kind of in this model and situation where it's actually really hard to learn. It actually takes time to learn. We certainly see even with time of day tariffs, which consumers can understand really easily, you know, there's still relatively low level of sophistication in terms of what's being offered to market so far. Some network companies, so this is not carte blanche, some network companies still don't seem to measure the full benefits of demand response. So I think some of the tariffs that we've witnessed, and this is only our view on it, but it appears that a lot of the tariffs that are out there that may try and create some form of demand response, they appear to be set based on the network company purely and simply gathering the same amount of revenue. Yet I think the opportunity of demand response actually is to value the opportunity of not having to forward invest. So that sophistication in the benefits of price signals, I think, needs to improve across the industry as a whole. Some of the network price structures or levels are genuinely meaningless to the customer, or they may be confusing to the customer, or indeed they may be plain bad for the customer. So we've heard today about the lack of uptake of certain tariffs and some smart tariffs out there. The reality is we need to understand collectively, both retailers and network companies, what is the benefit of that tariff. There are genuinely some smart tariffs out there at the moment. Certainly as we've analysed them for our customer base, that there's not a single customer that gets benefit out of that, and the load shift they would need to move to get benefit from that, we just can't ever see it happening. So That's the first message. I think the second one, from a structures point of view, is that some of those price structures and demand charges in particular, so we have a real challenge. We can't pass that on to the customer. There's no easy way of passing that on to the customer. Sometimes that actually disadvantages the customers as a whole. And I think the reason why is when the retailers look at that and they know they're going to be charged that from the network company, but they can't reflect that in a charge accurately to the end consumer, they go, there's a margin risk here, so what will we do? Well, we'll put our price up and we'll make sure that we don't take that margin risk. And so I think some structures that we might be contemplating, we have to think very carefully whether they can be passed successfully to the customer and whether there's margin risk that sits in that particular price structure. And finally, some retailers don't and possibly won't, when we're starting to think about the future, pass through, I'll use the word daft, pass through price structures or price levels that just don't make sense. So I think we all have to collectively start to get a sense of what are the structures that will make sense for consumers, what are the price levels that will make sense for consumers or segments of consumers, and actually price on that basis. So back to that kind of seesaw that we've got and that balance that's required. I think on the improving price signals, I think there's a lot of work going on, a lot of focus and a lot of thinking on that side of the fence, and I think I have real confidence that the network companies are starting to understand their cost structures and how they want to try and pass those through over time. On the consumer side, you know, interestingly, what are the metrics? Do we actually have any metrics of what a successful price looks like for a consumer? Is it relevant in the first place? Is it understandable? Is it comprehensible by them, or how long would it take to make it comprehensible? Is it actually valuable? So it doesn't make sense for certain segments, will they see value in responding to that particular price? Is it actionable? So actually, can they take action off that signal? Is it timely, for example, or do they receive it after the fact of consumption? Is it traceable? So our customers certainly love following it back to their bill. Is it measurable, and is it traceable back to the bill, or are we simply going to send a charge to the look and go, I hope they've charged me the right amount. And is it a choice for customers? So, you know, interestingly, I think what we probably need to do more work on, and I think it's collectively, is starting to understand, put real focus to, start to think about and start to understand from a consumer point of view what price structures and price levels with some categories of thinking actually make sense. And so I think in that balance, you know, we need to find ways of improving the price signal, improving cost reflection, but also ensuring that we get customer engagement. Those two objectives should sit very tightly together. So to the topic that I was actually supposed to talk about, interestingly, there's no doubt that the implementation aspect of this, the communication of it, the customer engagement is absolutely critical to the success. If we don't do that element right, then it will fall apart no matter what. I think a broad framework probably can be worked on and defined in advance, and I think we've seen a lot of that information from the previous presenter. But the specific activities, it feels like the specific activities and the level of effort that needs to go to things really is dictated to by those final price decisions, whether they're made collectively by the industry or how they come about. But I think when you think about the implementation, we really do need to know what it is that's going to be implemented before you start to think about how it will be communicated, how it will be implemented, the timeline for it. And so I think, you know, the main take out here is let's get the what right, or as good as we can first, then let's think about the how we do it and the when we do it, because if we don't know what it is we're doing, we might design a time frame that doesn't fit, for example. Thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much, Steve. There are a few things there which I thought we could actually build on in the discussion, but I think we'll stick with the process and we'll have another speaker and then we'll see if we can get the conversation moving. But our third speaker, we've already heard a little bit from here, says here that Jerome Chapman is the Deputy Commissioner for the EGCC, but I happen to know that Nanette is on holiday, so that means he is actually the Acting Commissioner at the moment, so be very afraid. So maybe with a slightly different perspective coming from the consumer side, Jerome, please.
Thank you, John. Jerome Chapman. Deputy Commissioner of the Office of the Electricity and Gas Complaints Commissioner. Very grateful for the opportunity to be able to speak to you and address you about this topic and give you our insight and observations on our experience in dealing with consumer impacts. So just a little bit about the EGCC. Over the last 10 years, we've dealt with over 50,000 inquiries and complaints. So that's us dealing with, impacts from the changes that you make in your companies. We've investigated over 2,000 complaints in the last 10 years, and those are in-depth investigations generally, and we call those deadlocked complaints, and we'll come back to those a little bit later. And finally, just of all the complaint issues that are registered at our office, 60 to 75% of those from year to year are about billing or customer service. So that's what we've been talking about today. Any changes that you make to distribution pricing, and if those are passed through, those are going to impact billing, and the way that you manage those communications will impact your customer service. So I just want to just give a brief story about, some impact that the actions that companies take can impact on consumers. So we have Mr. Jones, who owns a farm. Mr. Jones' farm has been in the family for generations. The family has power poles and lines on their property, which supply their neighbours. So decades ago, when the lines were installed, it was the neighbourly thing to do to give permission for those lines and poles to be installed on the property. Those poles have required replacement, and from Mr. Jones's perspective, the replacement has gone ahead without his notice. And between, myself and the audience here, we probably think that the impact on Mr. Jones is quite minor. But in Mr. Jones's eyes and the way that he uses his farm, he views the impact as something equivalent to this. So the pole might have moved a few metres, the pole might be slightly bigger, it might be concrete rather than hardwood, but from Mr. Jones's perspective, it's a massive impact. He doesn't like it. He feels he hasn't been consulted. I think most people would agree that the simple act of communicating with that particular affected consumer or landowner would go a long way to either mitigate or eliminate the impact on that particular consumer. So I just want to talk about four things in the 10 minutes that I have today, and I just want to give a couple more examples of impacts on consumers that we've observed. And that's not to point the finger at any companies. And the information that I'll display is available, publicly available information. It's in our annual reports and our 6-monthly statistics. So it won't be a surprise to many people in this room. I want to just talk briefly about resistance to change. And we've talked, I think most of the speakers today have talked about some element of change and whether people are willing to change or resistant to it. I just want to make some comments on communication and then just finish off with a few things that we all should, think about. So the two examples of consumer impacts that I want to talk about today is firstly a company, a distribution company, who direct bills and has a demand-based pricing structure. The second is a retailer who a few years ago made changes to their billing system. And I just want to show you the impact that that's had on the work at our office. So this is just a graph of a graph showing the percentage of deadlocked complaints, or the complaints that we investigate, which is represented by the blue line. So what you can see is that's data for the last 4 years. So this particular company, from 2013 to this year, 2016, the proportion of deadlock complaints relative to other distributors in the industry has ranged between 35% and 26%. And the bottom line, which you probably can't really see there, is an orange line, which represents the market share of that company. So this is a company, obviously, that has a lot of interaction with consumers, and that's a decision that they've made to front the communications with their customers about the way that they bill and basically to bill them directly. And this is an example of a retailer changing their billing system a couple of years ago. So you can see that after the billing system has changed, the blue line again has increased the proportion of complaints. So this company in 2015 had 22% market share, yet they represented 63% of all dead dog complaints that we investigated. So the point that I'm wanting to make is that the changes that you make, and these are changes that have been made individually by companies rather than by the industry as a whole. So potentially if the whole industry is making changes, then you can expect that this will have an impact on consumers. So I just want to talk briefly about resistance to change, and I thought I'd use a Dilbert cartoon to illustrate the point that I'm trying to make. And I understand that engineers and technical people relate quite well to Dilbert. So Dilbert's talking to his boss, and his boss says, "I'm getting reports that you're resistant to change." Dilbert says, "I only resist terrible ideas, but I can see how that would confuse you." So his boss says, "Whatever you're doing, cut it out." And Dilbert says, "Should I stop being rational in general or only in this one way?" And I think we're in this room, I think we've got engineers and economists and technical people who think that what we're doing or what we're about to do or what the EA is proposing is a good idea. And you can convince yourselves of that, but it's about convincing the people who are not in this room, consumers, that what you're doing is good for them. And I think that illustrates it quite well. So just another example, and I know Steve's talked about this just before me, but this is, I think, is also an example of consumers being resistant to change. So you have a pricing model which gives people or people volunteer to be engaged with responding to pricing signals. And I know that there's some constraints on availability of those pricing options, but still, this is a diagram showing the market share of retailers in New Zealand, and the big purple arrow is pointing to Flick Energy and Electric Kiwi, which represent less than 1% of the market share at the moment. So that's not to take away from what the companies are doing, but in terms of consumers who have the opportunity to have cheaper pricing, because that's the incentive to move generally to those new retailers, consumers are still very reluctant to do so. So can resistance to change be overcome by standard communication? And we've talked about communication quite a lot today, I think. And just as an example, there's about 1.8 million ICPs, and that give or take. So for us, that means that the EGCC, our contact details are on every single invoice that goes out every month, which means, and that's been a requirement for retailers since April 2010. So that means there's been 77 months since April 2010 with bills with our details on it. That means that there's over 140 million pieces of correspondence that has gone out over the last 6.5 years with our contact details on it, our name on it, yet we only have 6% unprompted awareness of the EGCC. So in terms of a communication message, when you are thinking about making change, I mean, the way that you communicate change is going to be quite important. And it's not about communicating to everybody. I think you're better off directing your communication to the people who will be directly affected by the changes you are making, and you can fully direct your efforts in communication to those people, because that's where it's going to matter. So just some things to consider. I think any change that you make will have an impact on consumers. And consumers basically want, and we've talked about this earlier, want reliable supply and at a reasonable cost. And I think Todd, I think, mentioned earlier that eight consumers on average on a survey in America at a conference that he was at spend 8 minutes a year thinking about their electricity pricing, or electricity, I think, in general. So that's a big, I guess, barrier for the industry to overcome if you're wanting people to be more engaged with pricing and being able to respond to pricing signals. I think a lot of the discussion today is sort of revolved around who's going to explain pricing. So I think retailers are a little bit uneasy that if 29 different distribution companies decide to change their pricing over the next 5 years, that you're going to have someone in your call centre who understands 29 different pricing methodologies and are going to be able to explain the differences in their pricing to that particular consumer. So I haven't heard really anything from the floor today about how that's going to be addressed and whether or not that's something that ends up or whether a solution to that is distributors taking their own calls and explaining directly to consumers, and whether that means direct billing. And also, given that companies are committed to making these changes, or some of these changes, do companies have adequate resources to deal with the impact that you're going to have on consumers? And that's a very real thing for consumers and the industry to think about. So, thank you, John. Well inside 10 minutes, I think.
Many thanks, Jerome. Sorry, it was so interesting. I was making notes rather than thinking about hopping up. So, so we've had quite a few sort of stage-setting comments. I'm ready to sort of return to some of them, but I don't know if anyone wants to build on any of the areas that our three speakers introduced there as a sort of tee-off from them.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Alan Davies. I'm with Grey Power. Our Grey Power, of course, represents some 70,000 members, 60-odd thousand households. All of those people, of course, are electricity consumers. Now, when it comes to making change, we introduced with a outfit called Pulse Energy a tariff called Grey Power Electricity. And we now have some nearly 19,000 people on that particular tariff, and all are members of Grey Power. The only way you can get onto that program is to be a member of Grey Power. So if you want to join, just come and see me. Now, the thing is that one of the things we insisted upon was that it had to be fully transparent, the bills. Everything had to be itemized. Now, we were told, of course, that nobody wants to know that. But I can tell you what, when we first started sending out these bills, we had a lot of people communicating saying, I've never paid for that before, why am I paying for this, why am I paying for that? But I can tell you today, if we took any one of those things out of the bills, we'd have complaints saying, why have you taken it out? We want to see what's going on. In fact, one of the things that has changed in the 3 years we've been operating now, of course, is network prices. And we just pass those through. We talk about pass-through, we pass them through. Now, when their price goes up, of course, it appears on the bill. We get rung up, why has that price gone up? The people are reading the bills, they are studying them. So that's something I think a lot of people are not aware of. People do read those bills. Now, the other thing I wanted to talk about is communication, because communication is absolutely vital. Now, then, just getting away from the electrical industry a little bit, and the New Zealand Transport Agency in June last year reviewed the gold card free transport. Now, they decided in that review that they were going to insist that Auckland Transport, who have a hop card system, that no one was to be able to use their gold card to get on transport there. They would have to have a hop card. And that was going to be introduced over a period of time. Now, of course, that was in June last year. Now, pre-Christmas, Auckland Transport started to make some noises about need to buy your hop card, they're only $5 at the moment. Until we got through to the fact that they're going to change this and no gold cards would be accepted on Auckland Transport as of the 1st of July this year. Come the middle of June, the amount of communication that had taken place was so poor that I insisted then that they had to put full-page ads in the New Zealand Herald to tell people what the hell was going on, which they did, fortunately. But even so, by the time we got into July, only half of the people who were eligible had got their hop cards. And in fact, it was only Monday this week we finally got to the point where the gold card being shown on transport in Auckland was no longer acceptable. But even so, still people are still doing it. So communication is absolutely vital. You've got to tell people, you've got to tell them way in advance as to what the heck you're going to be doing. So I certainly hope that this is something that, you know, is taken notice of here. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Alan. So we're sort of back to, we were talking about changing which side of the road you drive on earlier on. And, you know, was it the Swedes? They had a, you know, it was sort of like 2 o'clock on a Thursday afternoon and they just suddenly went, but it's pretty well communicated and nothing bad happened. Whereas there's a lot of other examples we've had in New Zealand where we've had this sort of rather sort of osmotic change where different people change at different times and it just takes decades for anything to actually happen consistently across the country, and maybe that's efficient. So there's really three areas that we can dive into, but I thought we might as well work through them in the order that we started. So the first of these is around transition, and Alan's raising quite an interesting point about accountability, I think, if I read you right, that where you have a change that's being mandated from the centre, but is being implemented in a distributed way, I'm hearing quite different things about what accountability different people need to take in terms of making this process effective. And Steve, I think you pointed out that in a relatively disaggregated industry where we have multiple parties dealing with the same end consumer, and even different distributors working with different drivers, the opportunity for miscoordination is quite large. And I guess we've had quite a good example of that in even in the deregulation of the electricity industry in New Zealand. Famously, the Cagle inquiry pointed out that the transition to full retail competition under an entirely self-governing arrangement had really missed the mark in terms of the high-level policy objectives it was after, because the establishment of the arrangements was completely inconsistent around the country because every single one of the incumbents devised their own processes in order to meet the legislation. And then we had a centrally led low-cost switching campaign with some centrally provisioned infrastructure. So I guess the first question is around accountability and who sees themselves accountable for what? I was sort of wondering how to ask the question. I mean, is it, you know, is it a blame question or is it a stick your hand up question? It's probably better to start as a stick your hand up question. But not wanting to sort of dob people in, but Graham, I did wonder whether through the work that the ENA has been doing, whether you've already staked out some territory where it's fairly clear that the distributors collectively will want to lead change, but whether there are other areas where you've identified that you require the authority to do something or you require other people in the industry to do something in order for your process to be effective.
No, we haven't done that yet. So the work that we have done was presented today by Emma. So what my personal thinking on this is that we do have to discuss this within our membership association and also talk to retailers as well and other stakeholders. And we're going to do that through our submissions, which we're going to be seeking on our new pricing options paper, which we're hoping to get out in a few weeks. My view on this is that there's going to be multiple parties involved in communicating this, and that is the distributors, and it's also the retailers, because the retailers do actually have that relationship with the consumers. So how are they going to communicate it? And that could be through their billing. They could communicate it in that way. I think the individual distributors are going to have to communicate it to their consumers in some way. They're going to have a communication process there and an engagement. And that could be through, you know, through media or through the retailers, perhaps. we don't have the answers. Also, what we would like to do at a national level is to help our members to communicate this. And we haven't got a project, but I'm going to be proposing one where we help communicate at a national level with consumers. And that would be quite a substantial project, so I'm not saying that we'll go ahead. So that's something that we want to do at a national level. And the other thing that we can do is that we can help our members communicate with consumers. And I think they've done a great job in Australia in doing that through producing communication guidelines. And that's something that we're looking at doing too. So the first thing for us is to get our two papers out and seek feedback on those, and then looking at the more specific things around what's the technical, what are the other barriers. For example, is there a barrier around billing systems? Is there a barrier around metering? And what do we have to look at around communication and transition? So I think there's plenty of opportunity. I think it's going to be really hard. And as someone who's worked in other sectors, I've worked in farming, chemicals, media, and also medicines, every sector has some sort of challenge and has some sort of group that's out to get you. And you're always going to have that. In my opinion, electricity is relatively benign. In chemicals, we had people permanently getting stuck into the chemical sector over organics or the bee industry or whatever. So we're going to have that. We're going to have a lot of negativity. We're going to have social media campaigns, and we're just going to have to accept it and try and push past it. It's not going to be seamless and perfect.
Jenny, did you have a sort of perspective you wanted to put forward through as sort of picking up the baton?
Thank you.
Who are you? Who do you represent?
Everyone else
in the room.
Jenny Cameron, Chief Executive of the Electricity Retailers Association. It was a question to draw on something that Steve had said about that there could be a broad framework defined in advance around this. And given the title of Industry-Led Adoption of Efficient Distribution Pricing from the EA, that one of the elephants in the room is, you know, this: if we don't do it, to what standard are we being measured against? When would or would the EA step in? Are there guidelines around what efficient distribution pricing is or what efficient pricing is? I understand there are pricing principles, and I heard that they were going to be reviewed early next year. So my question to the EA is there a view around what how they're going to coordinate that?
Do you want to have a crack at that, Craig?
Craig Evans, Electricity Authority. Let me just make sure I've got the question right. Jenny, are you asking what we think efficient distribution pricing looks like? Yes? Interestingly, in a paper we put out in 2012, the decision-making economic framework for distribution pricing, there's mention in that efficient distribution pricing would be nodal pricing, but that's not practicable at this time. That's just as a starting point that can point you to. But what is efficient distribution pricing? What does it look like? At the moment, we have the voluntary pricing principles. We're committed to looking at those in response to the feedback we got to the consultation paper over the next 6 months or so. And hopefully that will assist people in understanding the boundaries for efficient distribution pricing. But I think it's important also to add that as we've been clear to the ENA CEO forum a couple of months ago and other forums, is that don't wait for us to tell us exactly what to do or what it looks like. Our expectations can be predicted from looking at the statutory objective, strategic directions and so forth. And doing nothing in the absence of us not telling you exactly what efficient pricing looks like or what you think we should do is not a risk-free approach. We'll look at what people do, what they say they do, commitments, actions, timeframes and so forth, and look at the behaviours and reasons behind people acting or not acting. and consider our response in light of that.
And that's sort of the first of the two Neil Walbrand questions from earlier on. The second of Neil's two questions was sort of what are the early warning signals? So what are the signs that the authority probably needs to do to DEFCON 1 and do something about this? And Craig has very elegantly swerved that one and said, well, what do you think? And nobody heard him say that, so I thought I'd have another go. But, I mean, what I'm hearing from this is the authority saying we're sort of aware of the positive effects that backstop regulatory intervention can have in industry-led processes, but we're still sort of making our minds up about how and when we might do that. But I would be quite interested if people in the room had any views about what the early warning signals are, that it's getting a bit too late and you might actually need to come in with a heavy-handed directive approach to this rather than letting the laissez-faire approach play itself out. And if so, what those early warning signals might be and what indicators you'd need to be watching. Again, I'm thinking in Australia, there's a sense that they've sort of shut the stable door after the horse has bolted. So, you know, you've got some distribution transformers which have more than 50% of their connection points with solar on them, and now they're talking about changing their distribution pricing to help people make rational decisions about whether to invest in solar or not. Seems to me they would have been better to do that before people had put the solar on their roofs, because they're probably thinking a bit differently about it now. Yeah. So does that mean that you need to be looking at ICP penetrations on distribution transformers, and the minute it gets above 10%, then you regulate the bejesus out of it and all bets are off? Or do you think there's something a little bit more subtle we could do here? Just giving you the opportunity to contribute to people, but not hearing very much. I don't know if anyone's seen anything. Dr. Fletcher. Outbreak of doctors in the room. It's quite exciting.
I was trying to be quiet for the most of the day, and I might have to exit out the back door based on what I might say, because I haven't discussed it with eight members. But I think to answer your
question, can you introduce yourself to the people?
Richard Fletcher from PowerCo. I think the warning signal for me will be if this time next year we're still talking conceptually about possible options, and we haven't got greater clarity on what. Those options, how those options are being interpreted by individual lines companies. So it comes on to another point. I think we've got a really good opportunity during the ENA consultation that's coming on future pricing options to get to allow people like Steve to try and inform the debate on what pricing structures, I think you use the term, makes sense for consumers, feed into that. Then I think there needs to be a time for the lines companies to reflect on that and develop, look at what it means for them in terms of their billing systems, their data, the size of the change for that particular company. And I'll use PowerCo as an example. We have both ICP pricing and GXP pricing. Our pricing strategy is to move to a full ICP implementation over the next few years. In order to do that, we need to replace our billing systems. We've got to change our internal processes. We've got to engage with the affected consumers. So it goes back. I was talking to Jenny at the break. 2018, in my mind, is an unrealistic deadline. I think ENA and the EDBs need to actually put a line in the sand. And for me, 1st of April 2020 will be a reasonable target. That's the start of the next regulatory period. It's when we'd hopefully be shifting over to a revenue cap regulation. And then I think we need to put a line in the sand and say, by this date, the lines company will publish their own transition plans for review. And then we're all informed about what the reform is and how we might need to communicate and educate customers.
So it's just a personal perspective with no endorsement, but it's quite...
Well, it's a PowerCo-ish one.
Perspective.
Which I obviously need to discuss with my colleagues.
So that's quite... So that's quite constructive. So Jenny made the first move. She said, can we have it done by Christmas, please? The counter move is, well, you know, maybe we make a hard promise about having finished everything by 2020, but maybe some intermediate promises about publish an intention and in that publication set out what will have changed by when. Is that something the distribution businesses feel they could live with first? and I suppose flip side, is that something that the retailers would be satisfied with, or would they see that as being too sluggish? Right, easy.
I think the day a customer shows up to your door with something they want to plug in that you haven't got a pricing product for, you've lost the opportunity to preempt any impacts that might have, and the longer that goes on for, the more you build up a base of customers that are potentially out for some disappointment about what they're doing. So I think that's an issue for being too slow. I think Australia's issues are something that that we can avoid, but remembering Australia got itself into that position by messing its pricing up in the first place and the signals that it sent. My question would be, one of my board's standing rules is if the customers aren't complaining about it, why do you want to upset them by changing something? So we have to innovate within that framework. My question would be for Jerome and Alan is, I was interested in the question, you both seem to be in favour of disaggregating pricing components from the different industry sectors on consumer bills. Is that something that that you think customers actually want? Or, yep.
Hang on, let's have a microphone first.
Yeah, great power electricity customers. If we tried to change our billing system now, which of course is fully, you know, transparent all the way through, if we tried to change it, we'd have a revolt. People are now very happy with it. Initially, they questioned it. What the heck's it all about? Now they're very happy with it and don't want it to change.
Richard, do you want to?
It was just a clarification more than anything. When I talked about a 2020 line in the sand, that was almost a date, if you like, a date when the EA would look at the sector and go, has the sector sufficiently reformed to a cost of serve based pricing? Doesn't preclude any improvements happening from now up until that date, and that will be set out in individual companies' transitions plans. So.
But as a backstop for sort of some type of...
Recognising that some companies will have bigger reforms than others, and so we might be, for example, PowerCo may be able to do some things now, which aren't reliant on billing system change, but we'd be looking to move to full ICP pricing with cost-reflective tariffs which reflect a price structure which customers valued by 2020, and the Commission and the EA would look at that and assess whether we broadly met that objective.
But it would mean that for the retailers who were talking earlier on, you'd probably have pricing changes happening in a completely inconsistent way all around the country over a four-year period, just to suit the circumstances of the individual companies. Is that okay, retailers? Are we good with that? We all... Oh, Phil is back on the job.
Phil Anderson from Electric Kiwi. I guess a lot of the comments have kind of it's sort of been implied in it that there's this big bang, that one day everyone's on the current framework and then the next day everyone's on something else. And I understand from Vector's comments earlier that there would be a risk of cherry picking if you allowed these different plans to exist in parallel, but that you might also have a much more orderly transition. And, you know, even if it turns out that if customers engage on the new plans, that they can get a slightly better deal than, you know, staying on the legacy plans, there could be, you know, an orderly transition where people move to better deals rather than having this big big bang on the 1st of January 2020. Just interested on thoughts whether cherry picking issues can be dealt with and there can be a transition where multiple the new and the old exist together, or whether we need to have more of a sharp cutoff.
I mean, one of the things that occurred to me while we were listening to the speakers is there is a difference between input cost and delivered prices, and we do occasionally sort of slide from one to the other, right? You know, so Steve was talking about this, that a price, strictly speaking, is something that isn't resold. It's a price for a product that isn't resold. With very few exceptions, distribution pricing for the mass market is an input cost. Yeah? So we've got two lines businesses who do conveyance pricing where they contract direct with end customers. That's a price. Yeah? But everything else we're talking about is a cost. Yeah, and it gets presented to the non-reselling end consumer by the retailer. And the retailer has the problem of how does it manage the risk about that input cost if it's presented in a form that it can't pass through. That was the point you were making, Steve, about there are certain types of distribution pricing form that you technically can't pass through transparently. It's actually impossible to take a GXP price and pass it through transparently to an individual end consumer. And the GXP price isn't perfectly cost reflective because it measures it at the GXP, not at the subtransformer level. Yeah, so it's still an approximation. And one of the things that struck me about this is there's a sort of learning process here about demand elasticity, which is a bit the point you were making, that there's a lot of people who reckon they know all the answers in this room, yeah? And there's this very interesting social experiment that we're about to initiate, where 29 lines businesses and 30-odd retailers are all going to start experimenting with doing things, really just to try and expose the latent demand elasticity that we're not seeing in response to infrastructure capacity. Is that a sort of summary? And I'm interested in how on earth would you accelerate sharing the learnings from that process? Because it does seem to me that some of this is just empirical. You know, it's like behavioral economics. Some interventions in policy work better than others because people are people, yeah? They're not rational beasts and they don't do everything properly. But, you know, you require government agencies to do really stupid things for decades before somebody does it properly. And they go, oh, God, opt-in does work better than opt-out when you're dealing with retirement planning. That's an amazing insight. And it's almost just an empirical fact. But, you know, you can definitely bring the benefits forward. But it's not a process we've ever done. You know, the retailers are absolutely terrified that they'll be done for collusion because the Commerce Commission are horrible. And, you know, the distributors don't talk to each other because they're engineers and they don't really like talking to people. And it's jolly hard. So I'm interested if people had any examples of things where we have done that type of sort of shared learning, which might help accelerate the delivery of customer benefit, because that's really what the authority is interested in. I mean, that's where they see the efficiency benefits here. It's about exposing that demand elasticity, which results in avoided investment in unnecessary capacity. Is that right? So, you know, any examples of how we've done this sort of thing before and how that came about? Molly?
Molly Mellish, Dune. What I would like to see is the market monitoring system of the Electricity Authority to report in more granular detail how demand responsive households are. And in fact, all we see is reports on an average price. I would like to see the price that comes out per kilowatt hour to over a range of high versus low consumers. There is a potential for really granular reporting. And there's an Australian article on low fixed charges, which does show how the price works out for a high use, low income household compared to the rich people who are low use and have invested in so much. There's almost no data on which this price demand elasticity, it's a data-free analysis. So I would like to see the monitoring of the EA report the range of actual prices per kilowatt hour or even per kilowatt demand over a wide spread of consumers in a wide spread of regions in which distribution costs vary, perhaps greatly.
That's a very interesting thought, Molly. I mean, I suppose it's sort of built on our competition by comparison sort of regime, which was behind the original information disclosure regs that the lines businesses were under before Part 4, which does have some merits. I mean, the companies did look at one another and go, how come he's above me in the charts? I need to do something to sort of change next year. I don't know whether, I mean, none of Rory's gang are here, are they? But I'm interested in whether that's the sort of thing where increased reporting and analysis just to try and sort of nudge the learning process along might be of any interest. Craig?
Craig Evans, Electricity Authority. Monitoring of behaviours, understanding sort of actions and activities of all parties is something that we're thinking about, but one of my colleagues might be able to speak to the analysis that Molly was referring to.
Sorry, Brian Keelan, Electricity Authority. At the moment, we're actually doing some review of the reporting that we've got around retail pricing and costs. I think we're working with MB with that. It's not in my immediate area, it's with Phil. I can actually get Phil to give you a call and talk through what they're doing there, Molly, if that helps. Okay.
But I think that's a very constructive suggestion, that if, you know, we're all on a bit of a shared journey here, then actually sort of helping people understand what works best and what doesn't work so well. And as Steve says, you know, there are some things that are just downright sort of stupid, so you know, you might want to avoid doing those, learn from the others. And if, following Richard's suggestion, this is going to happen in a relatively sort of organic way, then there is the opportunity for some of the later companies to learn from some of the initiatives of some of the earlier companies. And you know, we were hearing at the beginning there are some very real incentives on most, if not all, of the Lions businesses to make this transition. So you'd expect that some people will start moving pretty quickly, particularly if they start seeing exciting things happening on their networks. I mean, it'd be true for you guys, wouldn't it? My impression is Tasman and Marlborough are much more concerned about this than most of the other companies, because you've got a swarm of solar installers all over the place, and you know, you go to work and you see this stuff happening. Whereas if you live in Buller, all due respect, it's sort of not really happening quite so much. Is that a fair call? Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's have a mic.
Yeah, that's right. We do have, I think, the highest uptake of PV, for example, of all distributors when measured as percentage of our ICPs. So, yeah, certainly something that we're looking at. But as I mentioned earlier, our penetration of smart meters has been, you know, not probably high enough to look at a number of the pricing options that we're considering at the moment. So there is that factor, plus the clarification of the LFC and how that works with regard to capacity pricing. Those factors will enable you know, us to move forward with looking at pricing options.
Very good. So that was a little bit on transition. There's a little bit of foot dragging I'm hearing here. You know, sort of quite like someone else to organise the meeting, and I'll come along. Oh, Nathan not dragging his feet. He's being proactive.
Just a bit thoughtful, John. Nathan Strong from Unison. Yeah, I think if there was one retailer and one distributor, then this would be an easy problem, because we could just talk to each other, talk about the systems, come up with a solution. It could happen in a couple of years. And you know, the problem that we're dealing with is that there are 29 lines companies, there are more retailers. So how do we sort of overcome that coordination challenge and not have 29 times 30 different approaches at the end of this? But we have got a process that's already in existence, and I guess as an industry and regulators, you know, we often use working groups, technical groups, to solve problems. So the ENA has got its distribution pricing working group. You know, we're about to publish the two papers around, you know, how do we move forward. We'll look for submissions. You know, it'll help us crystallise, you know, what some of the answers might look like. What are the go, no-go areas? And I think there's just an opportunity to leverage off those processes and think about just how we make sure that those not just deliver the technical options, but the roadmap
And I think we're all trying to grasp for a solution this afternoon. I'm not sure if that's really a productive use of our time. You know, I think we know what the challenge is, and it's just going to take, you know, some coordination perhaps through the ENA and ERANs to work out a process and talk to the authority about that and to see whether that meets, you know, fits the bill. You know, we've had some precedent around, you know, the rollout of the Model Use of Systems Agreement, and there's, you know, various disagreements around whether the authority is going to act prematurely in terms of that area. But, you know, we do have industry processes that we can leverage off, and it's just about turning our minds to using those processes again. That's just a view.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right, but there are people in the room saying, get on with it, hurry up, this is taking far too long, we'll never get there under the current approach, we've been talking about this for decades, blah, 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 so that's why we're here having this conversation today. I don't think it's a complete waste of time. I mean, the other thing, which again, you know, you could just let the process run, but I think it might be worth seeing if there's any more perspectives, is about customer communication. So if you go back to the consultation paper that the authority put out in November last year, it does see, there's got a little section, and it's called Distributors Need to Talk to Consumers About Pricing Structure Options. But equally, we've got people saying, well, hang on a minute, you know, is that a really good idea if you've got retailers who are actually managing customer relationships directly and they're also managing the communication? Are they going to be talking at the same time? Are they going to be talking about something different? Are they all going to be talking in the same room at the same time? Does this need coordination, or are we just going to be a bit loose? Toby.
Toby Stevenson, SAPA Research Group. Can I just take you back one stage to the timing? And it's really a question. The question is, what does success look like? And it's really a question back to Richard at PowerCo and to Craig at the EA. Is success that all lines companies have cost-reflective pricing available to retailers? Or is success the degree of penetration of delivery of those cost-reflective prices to consumers?
Craig Evans, Electricity Authority. Thank you, Toby. Let me just make sure I understood what you said. So success is distributors are making available cost-reflective prices, or is success how many consumers have taken up cost-reflective prices?
How many are flowing through?
What an interesting question. Does anybody in the room have views about that? I love silence. On that, I think at this stage is that, and this is consistent with what the authority has been saying so far this year, is about providing consumers with the choice and retailers with the opportunity to provide those choices. So consumers may choose not to adopt cost-reflective prices or whatever they look like, but as long as they've been provided with that choice by retailers or someone else, then that's perhaps okay.
So in your view, the timelines we're talking about and success would be measured by the number of consumers who have the cost-reflective prices being made available either directly from a distributor or indirectly through a retailer? We've heard a whole section in the middle of today about the fact that many retailers don't and won't necessarily pass the cost-reflective distributing prices through to consumers, and that in fact there's no strong incentive on them to pass them through until competition presses on them.
So going back to it, yeah, I don't think we're not, Craig Evans, Electricity Authority, we're not presuming particular choices by consumers. We're not saying that success, I don't think we would say that success is all consumers being supplied by some Flick-like product or by some electric keyword-like product or some other innovative product based on a cost-reflective distribution tariff or price. It's that they have the option, the choice there. I think also, just on this sort of thing, I think I'm in the right place. Something else we've also said in our ENA CEO forum elsewhere is that We're not expecting all distributors move at the same time. We've also said, so it's up to each distributor to move at their own pace. I think we've also said that we expect there to be missteps, and that, but at the end of it, there is a sort of an expectation that distributors move to providing consumers with the retailers, or whoever is taking up the option of cost reflective prices, whatever they look like.
Thank you. So back to my question about customer communication. So are we all good with distributors talking directly to customers as well as retailers? Is that fine, or do we need to talk about this at all?
Todd Bodless, Energy Strategies. We're in a room full of engineers and economists, and I hear the conversation about what and how, but from a consumer perspective, and communications being so important, the message the consumer needs to hear is why. We haven't had discussion on that. It's being directed by the Electricity Authority, and I think there's a responsibility to come out with a simple message that consumers can understand as to why. And I think that the success is going to be measured by prices not increasing consistently when demand stays flat, or consumers understanding how their increase in capacity, while consumptions remain flat, is reflected in increases in prices. People don't understand that.
But I suppose the interesting question is, so who has that conversation? Is it something that some government body has? Is it something that the retailer of the time has or doesn't have? Is it something the distributor has because it's in their own self-interest, because they're worried about asset stranding? Or is everyone going to have that conversation? So what is... put the microphone up. So I think you said it's everyone.
It's the industry. It's the industry.
Yeah, so the industry in New Zealand doesn't exist anymore. Yeah, I have this problem. I had a delegation from Bangladesh on Monday. Yeah, so we spent 2.5 hours failing to get through the fact that there isn't a coordinated industry which does anything in New Zealand. And it was just impossible, really. It's so different from this mindset that created ripple control, that created optimized hydro dispatch on the Waikato River. It's quite a different environment, and evolving that. You can't just tell the industry to go and do anything, which is a bit why we're having this discussion. And I think what the authority is trying to do is to say, well, you know, who's got the strongest vested interests in making the first move, and what else needs to happen to make sure that we don't... I mean, it's a bit like a sort of balanced scorecard thing, isn't it? You know, you could change your prices tomorrow, that's easy, but you'd probably annoy quite a lot of people in the process, and there'd be loads of collateral damage, so it's not a good option. But the question is, so what does the industry actually mean? Who makes the first move? Who calls the meeting? Who spends what money on what? What channels do they use? That's what I was sort of interested in exposing. And I am very interested in whether there's analogies from other industries which have been through things like that. So, you know, which side of the road you drive on. You know, government took the lead in that, absolutely. The change to TV, you know, when we moved from broadcast to digital TV, again, the government absolutely took the lead on that one, because really they had the strongest vested interest to make the change happen, because they wanted to free up radio bandwidth to do other stuff with it, so it's clearly in their interests. Mass market retail competition in electricity in New Zealand, we've tried two approaches. One of them had virtually no government involvement. The second one had quite a lot of regulatory direction in it, and there's a sort of level of competing interests. Yeah, so, but people, is anyone worried about, you know, they want to go and talk to a customer, but someone else has already been to talk to them about the same thing in a different idiom, about the same subject? Is that a problem?
Hi, Gareth from Trustpower again here. I guess I see it a little bit like how we've had, when we've had major price changes in the past, when like Wellington Electricity did that big price drop a couple of years ago, that they went out and communicated to the consumers saying what was going on, and then the retailers also did their communication, because the fact is that we might have a big bang on 1 April that all the networks switch over to cost reflective pricing, but certainly not all the retailers, to like Toby's point, a lot of retailers aren't going to move at that point in time. But I think at that point in time, you want all the consumers on those networks to know that the networks have moved that way and what the future looks like. And then the retailers, when they actually move their customers to that pricing, if they do, then also have the obligation at that point to communicate with the consumers what's going on. And then they can at least refer back to what the network's previous communication on the topic was.
And I think Greg was nudging us a little bit further and saying, well, if the lines business wants to draw a bit more attention to the options that are available which weren't in the past, the network might want to do a little bit more about it. What's my option or whatever. Interesting. There was a hand down here, but it wasn't you two. It was someone else. Okay. You can go, and then you can go. Jenny.
So I had a couple of points. First, on the smart meter point, I understand that even if we had perfect adoption of smart meters, it might only get up to about 90% throughout New Zealand, just because A, there are areas that wouldn't be able to have the smart meter read, or there are people who don't want them, and we have to respect that customer choice as well. So looking for 100%, there's going to have to be factoring in that not everyone will want smart meters in that. So that was that point. In terms of the transition, I wasn't advocating for a big bang either. There will be a phased approach. The issue was consistency. So across the country, distributors will move at different times, but it's if they're all doing it in different ways, that's going to cause a lot of issues for the retailers. So having that a consistency around what they do, which I understand is a lot of the work that the ENA working group is doing. The other point I wanted to raise was, and this gets back to the retailer pass-through, pricing is only one way in which a customer sees value out of what the services that they're getting. And we had the awards last week, innovation and the pressure on retailers to innovate more, to deliver more to customers in different ways is very, very strong in the sector. So we had Trustpower won Retailer of the Year last year for their bundling. And bundling of services is going to be something that comes in more and more, that's happening overseas. How those sorts of things are factored into this. And, Flix doing their new innovation and one innovation this year. What Electric Kiwi's doing, I mean, that's the point of what retailers do with the pricing models they get to deliver to their customers will be different, and that's what the competitiveness of the sector delivers for customers. So pure pass-through will work for some customers, it will work for some retailers, but as long as there's the choice, that's the key thing, that's the key factor. Those are my points, thank you.
Thank you. Graham, you had a...
I was responding to an earlier discussion, but just on the subject of outreach, we did a project last year through the ENA, a $100,000 advertising project around trees. So this was national advertising that was pitched at men who went out and chopped down trees around power lines. And what was really interesting about that was, even though I was overseeing that project and paying for it through members' money, I never once heard a radio ad on the radio. And what's really interesting about that is at Wellington Electricity, I must have heard 10 ads from Wellington Electricity. So, some things work and some things don't. And I think our project has worked, but Wellington Electricity seems to penetrate better in some ways. So there's all sorts of ways of channeling your communication, and some of them work and some of them don't. The other point I was going to make was around consumer outreach. We have taken a leaf out of the Electricity Authority's book when they published their discussion document in November last year on implications of new technology on distribution pricing, and I think they made a very good effort there to take their large document and distill it down to attempt to do outreach to consumers. And I think good on them for doing that. So the ENA board, and this was a suggestion that came up from the membership, is looked at the Arab pricing report, and they said, 130 pages, Graham. Yeah, so we want a similar consumer takeout of that. So we're also doing a short version. We've got our senior comms advisor, Brian Lingham, over here, and that's his job, to prepare a consumer takeout. And that's something that we'll be publishing alongside our longer report, our 130-page report.
Thank you very much. So, hang on, we've got a hand.
Yeah, Grant Thomas, Prima Solutions. I'm just going back to the issue of timing and transition and who talks to who. I think to some extent those are questions that can't really be answered until the detail of the what and so forth is sorted out. But I'd just like to draw attention to an issue around the immediate situation. So I imagine today, while we've been in this conference, New Zealanders, and I don't know how many, but you know, maybe sort of 15 or 20 Kiwis have committed themselves to quite a large investment in solar PV on the understanding that electricity pricing is likely to continue as it is today and has been for many years. And I'm just concerned about that, that those poor investment decisions are being made. And is there a need for some communication, probably kind of, I'm thinking electricity authority, to signal to people, to consumers now, that this change is occurring. It's going to take some time because there's some transition issues that need to be worked through. But be aware, because I'd be really pissed off if I invested in solar PV because I didn't understand that this change was going to occur.
Well, it sort of already happened, I suppose. The question is, and I mean, several of the lines businesses have done something about this themselves, haven't they? You've got your solar calculator thingy on your website. Various other people have done stuff. You're sort of saying it needs a sort of government thing, I think is what you're saying, Grant, because the government's better. But Graham's saying sometimes, you know, individual actors just get it right for their local communities in a way that somebody national can't, which I think was where Brent started this morning. Yeah. Any reflections, Molly?
Just that six-page consumer summary made it very clear to people that if you invest in solar, you're being mean to those people who can't afford to invest because those poor people's prices are going to rise. Now, that's based on a definition of efficient prices, which I personally reject, and that prices should protect the asset values of both the distribution companies and the generators at the expenses of the asset values of those people who have invested. Can't we protect the investments of people who in good faith are invested? And is it really fair to give the large companies an effectively guaranteed return when the individuals and small companies, like the small hydro generators, and for heaven's sakes, even people who invest in home insulation and LEDs, shouldn't those investments be protected equally?
Well, I'll let Brent sum up at the end, and I suspect you may hear the words durable and you may hear the words predictable when he's talking about how he interprets the statutory objective. It's just a hunch. But you raised consumers' reviews. George is here, isn't he, somewhere? I saw you earlier. I didn't know, I mean, because, you know, consumer doesn't have a statutory objective and doesn't have any accountability to Parliament or anything, and yet you have provided some great material, but unfortunately not all of it's available to the general public. Some of it's only available to your members. Yeah. Do you have a perspective on this? Because you are in a rather unique position of sometimes just working for your constituency and then sometimes being invited in by ICA and people like that to do stuff with them.
Yeah, well, we're in the...
Can you introduce yourself?
George Block, I write for Consumer New Zealand. We publish Consumer Magazine and occasionally submit on these things. But our problem is we combine like the the position of a non-profit organisation with also being a media company who has to make money. So obviously, like, our articles on solar PV and smart meters can only be made available to paying members. But yeah, I echo Molly's concerns that we need to, there needs to be a more coordinated, transparent sort of information about upcoming price structures. Like, there are people currently investing in solar PV with no idea that there's going to be changes further down the line. And probably on a more basic level, I'm also involved with PowerSwitch, which consumer managers, and I get phone calls from people who are being billed by lines companies saying, look, my bill last week was $800, and I say, like, well, this is how the pricing works, you know, it's if you have instantaneous power consumption, they say, what? What does that mean? You know? And there's sort of a basic level of understanding that's not there. And it's going to be a really challenging PR thing. And I think that also would mean we'd need a coordinated approach, because if everyone, if all the lines companies change on a staggered basis, you know, like every year another one switches, it's going to be pretty hard to communicate to people, like how they can best save money with these new price structures. So, yeah.
Yeah, no, thanks for that. I mean, it does make me think, Jenny mentioned the awards. I'm a judge on the awards. And one of the awards that we shortlisted was, it's got a name, but this is a safety collaboration between all of the major generators. And it's an absolutely fascinating organization. It's an industry initiative. And what happens is whenever any of the major generators have a major safety incident, they invite somebody from one of their competitors to come in and peer review the incident afterwards. And it's the sort of thing which requires colossal amounts of trust within the community. Talking to the guys and reading the submissions, it sounds as though it was very, very difficult to get it off the ground in the first instance, because there was a lot of anxiety that it would just become a massive beat up. But it's actually resulted in an enormous amount of learning. And actually, they're almost at the stage now of rather looking forward to the intervention of the colleague from outside the company, because it gives them a sort of independent way of advancing their understanding. And, you know, Nathan was telling us about the market research that Unison's done. That's talking to exactly the same thing you're talking about. You know, people have some customer groups have a very basic lack of understanding of, you know, just what the bits and pieces that they're working with are, let alone what options are open to them. But, you know, if every single one of the lines businesses does exactly the same piece of market research, that's pretty inefficient, right? But there may be ways in which the industry can, you know, possibly share more material than it currently does with a view to sort of accelerating this learning. And I'm sort of intrigued. What's it called? It's called Stay Safe or... Stay Live, that's right. But I don't think government or regulator or anything had anything to do with that. I think it was a sort of coalition of the willing job. I can't remember what the catalyst for it was. But and there have been some other really good examples. That's right, when the authority threw the medically dependent consumers idea back in the retailers' faces, that then became an industry initiative which had absolutely no coordination or involvement from either government or the regulator. And, you know, my observation is it seems to have gone quite well. But the question is, what does it take to get these things moving? Because, you know, often they can be very good. I don't know if anyone's got any other suggestions of analogies. Can we have a mic down the front, please? Sultanat, just here.
Thank you, Jenny Cameron, ERANS. Just a question to the room, because I don't know the answer, and I understand there was history, but the What's My Number or the switching campaign requires coordination across the industry. And is that as important as this distribution pricing work? And so my personal view is there has to be coordination, because otherwise we have to have that. The why we're doing this has to be a consistent narrative across everyone. Otherwise, then each will tell their story to their own customers, and there will have to be retailers doing it, has to be distributors. We'll all be there, but we have to have a clear story as to why we're doing it. And that, I think, there is a role, could be a role for EA in that. Do you have the eco guy coming on saying, here's this new stuff's going to be coming? You'll be able to stay on your current plan, you might be able to switch. It'll link into the switching. It's going to have broad impacts across a lot of different sectors. But I'd be interested in views around the room as to whether it is as important as switching to the sector and to get it right.
Do you have a view on, well, just before we get to you, Greg, George, the history of Power Switch is that we used to have multiple competing switching tools, none of which were really very successful, one of which was Power Switch. And then my memory is that the authority came in behind Power Switch and gave it some support and funding. And I don't know if you've got any views about whether it would have been better just to start off with some government-funded centralised process.
I think we do a really good job with Power Switch. We've started, as most of you will be aware, clipping the ticket on referrals that go through, and I think that's a really good model, very sustainable, but I think, we hope. But I don't think that it necessarily has to be a government-mandated thing, you know. We've also seen in the sort of world of tax refund providers, you know, that sort of broker model could work, but the trouble is if that doesn't have access to all the information. I mean, I think the best option would be to link in the sort of consumption data amendment with something like Power Switch and maybe have more industry buy-in on that. So you could have your historical consumption data immediately feeding into a bill and showing that, look, this cost-effective tariff, which obviously we called something else, would really save you a lot of money, then immediately refer you to the site. That would require a huge amount of coordination, but some sort of process like that could really ease the transition and mitigate some of those communication issues, especially if it was free to everyone and really easy to use and had that consumption data.
Greg, did you want to do something next?
Yeah, thanks, John. Greg Skelton, Wellington Electricity. We're in grave risk of forming a piece of work coming out of this, and that's really around the communication area where we all have to work together, and I think Jenny summed it up quite well. The problem with going into a market that's not warmed up and suddenly talking about the most difficult thing, which is pricing, is a bit fraught with a bad outcome. So I think we need, and we've talked about the EA taking a lead, is people like to move from something when they understand where they are now and what the future is going to look like. So without the understanding of now and going straight to the future, it's too much change, too soon, too quick. So there is a work stream that does need to sell the idea of what's happening, and then we can move to the better place. It happened with healthy homes, and I think people realise now that it was really sold on the health benefits for family and young people, not getting in damp homes, getting all of those respiratory illnesses, the elderly, the same issue. So it was really around the sort of looking after the family. It's really about insulation, it's around energy reduction, efficiency, and some of those sorts of things. But if we sold it as an industry around electricity, it probably wouldn't have got up. We sell it around health and benefit to people personally, people buy into it. Similarly with electric vehicles, you'll see branding of that, which is around CO2 emissions, sustainability, reduction in $13 billion a year of oil imports, and it's cheap. It's 30 cents a litre to drive your car, not $2. But the issue may be around supporting electric vehicles working in around networks which have a period of time, if the price signals are correct, outside the peak evening period, are very cheap to fuel. You know, our line charge at the moment is roughly 2 cents at night to fuel your vehicle. Getting those messages into with retailers is quite important, because the corollary of getting that wrong is everyone goes off. And doesn't matter who you are in the industry, no power because it's new piece of technology is coming and turn the lights off, everyone's going to say, what were we doing? Were we away at that period, or is the industry dead from the neck up? So seeing these things, promoting them and not actually having the signals really digs a bit of a hole in front of us we're all going to fall into. So working together, basically educating people about how the industry works now and some of the flaws it's heading to. If we don't change our direction, we'll probably end up where we're heading type stories, and saying there's a change that needs to be afoot, moving to something that's going to be more sustainable and basically stop a whole lot of investment that doesn't need to occur.
Thank you very much. Right, well, that's quite a nice little summary of where we've been going, actually. It's good. So I think we'll draw that session to a close.